Hope you had a good lunch. Great. So thank you so much for joining again us at the keynote room. And we have our next keynote speaker, closing keynote speaker for the day, Swati Joshi. And my friend said that I have to take the name correctly. And I can, I hope so. about her, she's amazing personality. I've been following her for a very, very long time. She does amazing work in IT, and she works with Oracle SaaS. Apart from that, she's a wonderful dancer. She's been practicing Bharatanatyam, a form of an Indian dance, for over 20 years, and she keeps on performing at different places. Also, she works with a lot of nonprofit organizations, one in India with the school, and one in the Bay Area, which is a Forte group, wonderful nonprofit for women in cybersecurity, women in technology, and to add to more. But I can go on and on for her, but I'll let her take over the stage and do the honors. Over to you, Swati.
Whoa! Too much love. Thanks so much for having me. I'm Swati Joshi, and we'll be talking about building a product security organization. A little bit about me. I've been in the security industry for about 14 years. I come from development background. I had the privilege of working in different security technical domains early on in my career. I started out as a security analyst doing SOC work, forensics analysis. Then I did some risk analysis work, moved into compliance. Then I joined Gartner as their application security engineer, and then moved into management there. From there, early part of my career, I was working a lot on preventative security. So at that time, I didn't have a whole lot of defense experience. And then an opportunity came along to work at Mandiant. So from a management role, I moved to an IC role and worked at Mandiant, helping companies through APTs. And then I continued my defense career at Netflix, leading their detection and response team. And currently, I'm at Oracle. I'm the VP of SaaS Information Security there. Oracle SaaS business is a multi-billion dollar business. We're responsible for 80 plus applications across 21 cloud regions. And we're about 22,000 engineers, developers in this line of business. So in the next 40 minutes or so, you and I are going to be building a product security organization together. Hopefully, we'll avoid buzzwords and keep it real. We'll start with how native cloud AppSec teams have been evolved. We'll talk about the current challenges. Then we'll talk about right-sizing the security investment for the company. We'll fight for budgets, we'll fight for headcounts, we'll fight for developers, we'll fight along with developers. We're gonna lose a lot of battles, but we're also gonna win some. Then we'll talk through the fundamental building blocks of security program. We'll talk technical details for each domain, and then we'll move over to leading people and organizational philosophy. In all of this, if an incident hasn't happened, and if you haven't done anything stupid, you get to keep your job and keep moving. So in between all of this, we are also gonna play a game of bingo. Some of you, I think, have the cards. If folks don't have bingo cards, they're up front. Please feel free to take some. On the one side, we have buzzwords that we all use. We have risk, scale, change. And on the other hand, we have zero trust, hacker hoodie. So we need a balanced approach to the buzzwords. Exactly like we need a balanced approach in building our security programs. So as I'm talking, as I'm going through this talk, depending on how many buzzwords I say or not, you can circle them and you can count them, the number of times I say it, and then let's do a true up at the end of the session. All right? Yes, please do not yell bingo. I think it'll be too many bingos too many times. To start building our security organization, let's learn from the past and let's look at the future. If we start considering what was going on early part of the last decade, early part of the cloud journey, right? There were three main themes. Code is getting pushed every day, multiple times a day. Merging of development and operations team, DevOps, DevSecOps, there was a huge wave of that. And as infrastructure costs saw a shift, you know, attacks started getting cheaper. So we saw a lot of fraud, phishing, RAS, ransomware as a service continues to exist. Now in the later part of that cloud journey, all of these things are not only true, they are now the norm. And now what we are seeing more of is systems are growing dramatically, right, like in complexity. That's also because the problems we are trying to solve are growing dramatically. Developers have a lot of frameworks to use. And then we've also realized that since shifting left, for large organizations, shifting left actually takes time, intentional action, and also takes a lot of capital. And the third theme that we are seeing now is partly because of the interconnectivity of the systems and the normalcy and the number of breaches, recovery is getting much more expensive. So this is our new reality. Now let's fit our security program for this new reality. So to do that, what does that look like? There are about six factors you'll have to consider while building the program. I'm sure there are more, and I'd love to talk to you all about what I might be missing here. So if you look at the left part of the sun, they can be grouped under an initial baseline exercise. You're trying to figure this out, you're trying to scope it out, you're looking at what cards you're dealt with in an organization. And on the right side, this is mainly based on building strategy for your security program. So it's based on input from the left on the right side. So the first one here on the initial baseline is revenue. We as a security community actually are doing a pretty good job here. We are shifting the value proposition and perceptions of the security program. We want security to be a business enabler, and we've been doing pretty good with that in the last couple of years. So we wanna look at the revenue of the company and how can we build a security team that matches. Next, we need to talk to executives about how important they or their customers think security is, right? There are kind of two flavors here. What's their appetite to invest in security? Is it a financial company? Is this in a highly regulated market where security is existential for them? Then there is also appetite in the sense of risk threshold. What's the risk threshold of the organization? Is this a high threshold organization? Is this a low risk tolerance? What does that look like? This is important to think about because later when we are talking about building the actual team, this will come in handy. The last one in the baseline category is proportionality. Number of libraries in the stack, number of lines of code, number of applications, number of developers, engineers in the organization, right? What does right-sizing the security org for those numbers look like? So of course, these factors evolve and change over time as your security team grows, and then we need to adjust accordingly. So we've done the initial baseline now, so let's build our security strategy. First, we need to figure out what we are trying to protect. Is it user data? Is it company IP? Is it brand? Is it trust? Is it reputation? Is it all of the above? We are trying to protect something. In the same vein, we are also trying to prevent attacks from happening. So while thinking about what do we want to protect, it'll also be helpful to scope out basic attacker motivations. After that, you really want to get a read on the existing level of the program, right? if you're stepping into a post-breach scenario, or if you're in a high-growth startup, or if it's a healthcare company, if it's a bank. So all of that is gonna look very different in terms of where the maturity of the program is. When I talk about state of maturity, I definitely am not talking about number of people, because I don't think they directly relate. You know, in a sense, some of the basic indicators of maturity, right? Like, do we have an incident response program? Do we have a well management program? Do we know what specific compliance requirements we need to adhere to? Do we have a risk register? And then moving on to sort of your third bullet for building a strategy, you know, building and buying. There isn't kind of anything unique to argue about here. I think they're not mutually exclusive, right? Like we often say build versus buy, but I don't think they're mutually exclusive. Sometimes building can be expensive, especially if you're in a situation where you don't have a whole lot of time and then you don't have a stopgap solution. In some other cases, maybe you're gonna buy now with the plan to build later or even outsource the entire function. So at the previous company, we built the case management solution, but at Oracle, we bought one. So bottom line, take a read of these three different indicators, figure out what the best next path is to build your program. So far, we've taken a stock of the company, we've taken a look at the risk appetite, we've talked to executives about their willingness to engage, we have a fair idea of what we want to try and protect. Now let's look at some of the basic building blocks, fundamentals of what we wanna do next, how we wanna execute. So we wanna build an efficient, sustainable security program. This means we need a set of management practices and technical approaches to get it done. Obviously, my intention here is not to give you an exhaustive list, but touch on some of the high-level themes. In the middle here, you have, you know, the grind, the actual doing of the work. And then on the left, you have some levers that you can use to accelerate and unblock your team. And on the other side, we need to measure the effectiveness of our program. So we need metrics and we need data. So the first bucket here is increasing leverage to unblock your team. So Simon Wardley explains this idea of pioneers, settlers, and town planners, right? Pioneers work on poorly understood problems, settlers like maturing the products, and then town planners like standardization. We need all these three functions when we are looking to build our program. There may be one specific area that's new, there are more pioneering work cycles to be done. Maybe there is another initiative that's a bit more mature, we need town planners there. Another idea we can borrow from product management and startups is this idea of product market fit, right? So if we extend that to security, let's fit our security solutions to the current life cycle of the application. You know, startups sweat a lot about product market fit. If you go in too early, there are no buyers. If you're too late, then somebody else has already solved the problem for you. The analogy of that hockey stick growth, right? Like if that growth doesn't exist. Very similar for us. We need to get the timing right for our products. You know, we need to adapt to the needs of the business and engineering teams. We have to introduce the products, you know, right place, right time. The second one, you know, one of the things that I'm seeing increasingly in security teams is now that we're shifting left, we need to manage, you know, the ops load that we have with the dev work or the efficiency gains work that we want to do. So how do we want to manage that? Maybe you are in a team where the focus is building more tools and there are no town planners who are managing other tools. Or maybe you're in a team where it's the flip side, right? Like you're always working on standardization and there is no scope for innovation. So one strategy to use here to balance this work is through OKRs, through objectives and key results. So if you have this big rock, you know, pebbles and sand approach, big rock is this one thing that you absolutely have to do that goes in the jar first. And then pebbles you can work with, right? Like, what are some of the efficiency, small little things that we could do on a regular basis? And sand is urgent work, not important. We all have to do that. For example, on the incident response team, when the responders are not on call, you know, following that ebb and flow of the incident, when they're not on call, they're working on updating playbooks, updating runbooks, maybe writing tooling, maybe maintaining their SOAR infrastructure, all of that. And then currently, my vuln management and penetration testing teams are working on something called as a finding assignments engine. Right, like this will kind of route the bugs and vulns to the right team and give them sort of gentle reminders about priority and about mitigation and closing those out. You know, automation is kind of another lever you have that you could use. Obviously, you know, automating repeatable admin tasks is sort of a no-brainer. We at Oracle, in our risk management team, we are using a homegrown risk management solution. You know, we have an Apex application that does risk assessments, sends out reminders to owners. It's our, you know, acts as our risk register. One thing that we are seeing here is initially with automation, there are huge gains, right? Like, we've also seen this with case management. Our mean time to assemble, mean time to resolve, like, really drops, and it gets better. Later on, the gains are smaller and incremental. Usually you get to sort of a stable state. You've done all this upfront, we are getting the returns, and then it kind of normalizes. So I think one thing that we are missing right now is we need some kind of a detection system in place to detect when the returns are diminishing on automation if we really want to, you know, measure the effectiveness and right size it. So we talked about, you know, how we can increase leverage through automation, balance, you know, ops load. Now let's talk, you know, a little bit about getting things done. We'll touch on vuln management, we'll touch on risk and compliance, you know, defense operations, and a red team. For vuln management, we have two tracks. We have a two-track approach to this. There is, obviously, we have a P0 track. This is the ad hoc track, and we have a continuous remediation track. So with P0s, we obviously directly don't want to take on the CVSS score, and the numbers are just really high. So we've introduced sort of the environmental variable, right? Like, how does this vulnerability apply to our environment? How many occurrences are we seeing, you know? Is there a publicly available exploit? This definitely has helped us with vulnerability prioritization. And so we have built this internal taxonomy to understand the risk and impact to our SaaS application. On the continuous vuln management cycle, that's pretty straightforward, follows the regular cycle of detect, prioritize, user automation engine. For assignment, then we'll talk a little bit about our security champions or security ambassadors program that work directly with engineering teams to get that closed out. Compliance is interesting. You know, we generally look at compliance as seen by folks as like checklist security, not effective. There's a lot of conversation around risk-based program versus compliance-based program versus threat-based programs. I think we generally think of it as like zero or one, I don't think it's that kind of distinction, right? Like, just like how we have defense in depth, it's a layered approach. I think we need a layered risk mitigation approach too, and compliance can be one of the layers and one of the tools. By no means is it a silver bullet, right? And if we lean in too far on the checklist, it can definitely be dangerous. The reality is there is an entire industry around this, and it has become an accepted way to provide assurance to our customers that, yeah, we are doing what you're asking us to do, right? So I've seen kind of a hybrid approach in terms of setting up the compliance program. I think you can have, within security, you can have full-time staff working on this and then also leaning into vendors and partners for their services for this function. So preventative controls, risk management, you know, continuous vulnerability management, all of that is great. But when inevitable incidents happen, we of course need our defense operations team. So depending on the type of infrastructure, the type of environment you're operating in, you may have a large team, a small team, or a team with specific requirements, right? I've seen a couple of approaches, a couple of different approaches that work well here. I've seen a fully outsourced, you know, 24/7 first level triage being fully outsourced, and the second level IR team being in-house. I've also seen a very lean SOC approach that focuses on automation. Currently, we have different environments. We have a gov environment, we have a commercial environment, so we have a couple of different SOCs for that. So let's talk a little bit about the red team. You know, I've been part of organization where I've used three different strategies for this. So if you have a really good start in risk quantification, if you have a really solid threat modeling program, then you have your loss scenarios, you have your attack paths. Maybe you don't need a red team that continuously hammers away. And then I've been in an organization where we absolutely had no funding for the red team, so we leaned in using, you know, vendor-driven red team engagements periodically. Currently, we finally established a red team within my organization. It took, you know, 7 to 8 months to show value, and we're having some early wins there. We've been doing some campaigns. We are hoping to, you know, take the learnings from there, push that into our detection cycle, push that into our risk register, and also take the learnings to get better threat intel and hunting. So now things are getting interesting, right? Like, we have vulnerability management, we talked about DART, we talked about red team, we talked about compliance. In the end, what we wanna get is a really holistic view. Right. If there are multiple applications, we want to know which application is healthy, you know, which application is risky from the other. So we want to put that data together. So we've been working. We are in the initial stages of this project where we are trying to pull kind of various data sources together to form this risk view. We have our application list. Then we pull our relevant incident information that's happened in the last quarter. Information from our threat modeling exercises, what are specific groups that might be targeting this application based on their TTPs, any findings from compliance report, any findings from our risk register. So really we want to create this overall risk view. And I know a couple of application posture management companies are trying to do this as well, which is really great to see. So we've covered a lot of ground. You know, last piece in the foundational aspects is metrics. So metrics, this is a big topic, we, I think, as an industry, we've been grappling with this for a while. Let's talk through a couple examples, right? Let's continue the thread of examples that I've brought up. Number of vulnerabilities. I always have trouble with this metric. Because what do I do with that number, right? Like, it depends on coverage, it depends on completeness of the scans, it depends on, you know, how many systems are we scanning. So let's look at maybe a bit more tangible ones. Okay, number of incidents, right? Yeah, we can do something there. There's number of incidents, we can do some trending over time, the types of incidents we are handling, we can do mean time to resolve, mean time to assemble. But in general, all of these metrics are like operational or baseline metrics, right? Number of detections, SLAs. They give you sort of the lay of the land, but there isn't any specific reduction or action involved with those. And then, of course, for organizational health, we can do OKR metrics, right? Like, you know, are we setting healthy goals for the team? Are we pushing ourselves? Are we moving in the right direction? these are all okay, but not great. So what we really want to get to is sort of that relative indicators. How did implementing one control reduce risk someplace else? By implementing this control, did we see a drop in the number of incidents? One gotcha here, one thing to be careful of is when you kind of lean into kind of the risk reduction metrics, right? Like it's very easy to look at that and say, oh wow, we're doing such a good job. We're reducing all of this risk, we're doing great. I think this is where like red team simulations are quite helpful. When you do the red team simulation and there is a new attack path, now we can take a look and see, okay, well, we don't have enough controls there. Maybe we wanna focus our energies there. So we've talked about the fundamental elements of the security program. Now let's switch gears a little bit and talk about leading teams and organizational philosophy. As security teams, of course, we interface with our partners, our engineering leaders, you know, legal, HR, physical security. Security is a centralized function, but the mission of security needs to be decentralized. You know, one example that I wanted to talk about is this, security champions or the ambassadors program. Through this program, we can embed security into kind of the wider organization, right? And we have security ambassadors who help with prioritizing product features, you know, pushing for bug closures, architecture reviews, all of that. So right now we have a number of ambassadors. We've built very strong relationships with our engineering team, lot of great benefits from kind of decentralizing. And you also see sort of this decentralizing example in a couple other places, right? Like how can we push alerts directly to the app owners in sort of that lean SOC automation kind of environment. The second point is about kind of diversity of thought, tying it back to the pioneers, settlers, and town planners, right? We need different voices, different backgrounds, and different perspectives based on our upbringing, our demographic, you know, our ethnicity. We definitely think about problems differently. And if we wanna be a team that can handle diverse threats, we need to have diverse perspectives. Look, like all organizations have, you know, finite people and finite, money. So sometimes we really have to make some hard decisions and accept the risk. Let's consider the example of, say, we are moving away from one environment, we are moving to a new tech stack, and for some time we are gonna be operating in both of these environments. So now there comes a point to make a decision of, okay, are we gonna invest in both of these? Are we just gonna invest in one? Are we just not gonna be monitoring the other? So as leaders, I think, you know, we cannot close all the gaps. We can make it easy for our teams by placing the right bets and focusing them to where it matters the most. And that's something that we as leaders can do. So in all of this, I haven't talked about communication and stakeholder management, right? There are a couple of avenues that I wanna talk about where we can do this effectively. The first one is, you know, risk register and the risk committee. Of course, there is, you know, this is an opportunity for us to curate risks, talk about risk mitigation and risk acceptance. Then incident summaries and post-incident reviews are another place where we can have, you know, blameless conversation about how do we improve from this, how do we learn from incidents, how do we make sure that the same incident doesn't happen again. And then the last one and often overlooked is like the strategic threat intelligence report. We obviously don't wanna create reports that no one reads or for the sake of creating reports. But if a report is packaged right, like if it has relevant information, industry comparisons, specific targeted TTP breakdowns, and associated detections, I think it can be quite a powerful message for the organization. So bottom line, you know, democratize security, build a diverse team, place the right bets, and manage expectations. Those would be sort of the four foundational pillars to continue to build your team. So moving along, you know, from leading people to organizational philosophy, I'm going to talk about kind of four organization tenets: change enablement, adoption of common frameworks, and then managing conflict, and of course, you know, org culture, org structure. So obviously, we security folks, we are not experts in org design or, you know, org psychology, but we are often forced to play the role of change catalysts or change enablers, right? Like who are bringing about that change. What we've seen is the FUD, like fear, uncertainty, doubt, that type of language you can't influence with that for too long. And there has been a shift, a welcome shift. So that only takes you so far. We've talked about the ambassador program, which I've implemented in a couple of places with great benefits, right? It's time and tested. We've talked about the metrics-driven approach. When we show data, metrics, how data and metrics have informed our decision-making and informed our investments, that really resonates with the audience. We've talked about transparent incident communication. One of the things me and my team have done in a couple of places is trying to do an annual incident review, like this kind of DBIR style incident report that we put together, and I have a presentation on every year. And it helps people to see, you know, what real relevant issues the organization is facing. You know, moving on, I'm not gonna talk too much about this because Anna did such an incredible job talking about it in the morning keynote. You know, when we give easy to use, secure by default tools and libraries to developers, we've seen a huge, you know, productivity and security gains. This is easy to put on a slide, but we all know it's extremely difficult to implement. I'm sure a lot of us are probably in a heterogeneous environment, right, where Node.js, Python, Java, they all coexist. And add to this mix, there is version incompatibilities and platform idiosyncrasies. You know, in a way, to do this well, we need investment. So the way I have made a case for this is by talking about vuln management and then the downstream effect of that on the application, right? We all would rather fix the vuln in one library than multiple pull requests. So conflict, so say when you lead a team of 100 people and then they're talking to, say, another 400 people, when they interact with, you know, other partner teams and teams within, conflicts are bound to happen. We should try to stop, you know, conflicts. We can't really eliminate them. I think instead we need to figure out a way on how to handle that better, right? During my first role as a security analyst, it was the company, the biggest customer for the company was USAID, so it was a lot of aid work, and security was an entirely new concept. And it was the first time the company was investing in security, and everything we introduced was seen as a friction, right? So one of the resources that's helped me a lot in understanding is the concept of, you know, FSNP. It's forming, storming, norming, and performing. You know, what stage of the life cycle is a specific team in or your partner team in? Like, how are they thinking about this? So understanding what specific phase they're in has definitely helped get me like better strategies on figuring out what the conflict is. You know, so as sort of, you know, our organization is coming together, the question of decentralization and centralization always comes up. Of course, there is no right or wrong answer here, right? I've seen a few different flavors throughout my career. Generally, what works is some kind of a hybrid approach. I'm a fan of like mission-driven teams. So if there are teams that with similar missions, they need to be grouped together. And at the end of the day, it's about balancing agility. We want to be fast, we want to be nimble, but at the same time, we want to be in alignment with organization priorities. And And you'll kind of see in the cycle, initially teams will be centralized, then they'll move to a decentralized format, then they'll be centralized again, just trying to figure out, you know, which do we want to do agility, do we want to do standardization, depending on that. And of course, it changes because leadership changes, the business changes, things like that. I have, you know, next couple of slides, I wanted to talk to kind of our vendors and partners who might be attending this conference. As practitioners, we all get pitched with products, right? Let's be real. We need them. We need some more than others. Like I mentioned earlier, there is always a little bit of build, a little bit of buy. So when it does come time to buy, do we need products that are generalized or do we need products that are specialized? Do we need a Swiss Army knife or do we need something more specific? My philosophy here has been to pick specialized tools to do specific tasks, as long as they play nice with the rest of the ecosystem. This has allowed me to pick sort of the best of the breed products and also have comfort in knowing that that was probably the right decision for my team long term. Taking this further, how do we think about solutions versus platforms, right? Solutions are great. They help you to get the job done. But are they going to work for me 2 to 4 years down the line? You know, is the ROI going to expand or diminish, right? Like when the next downturn comes along and I'm asked to slash vendor budget, am I going to fight for it? So I'm biased here as well. My experience in building kind of scaled security organization tells me that platform is the better strategy here. What do platforms give you? Platforms gives you extensibility and pluggability. They can support sort of the growth of the organization and ensure that the dollar goes further. So thanks for sticking with me so far. So in kind of my final conclusion takeaways, you know, for fellow practitioners, let's keep, you know, security technology fit top of mind. Let's fit our solutions to the current life cycle of the application. You know, let's think about how to measure effectiveness early on in the product or project life cycle, not, you know, later on let that not be an afterthought. Application volume, interconnectivity, and complexity kind of are here to stay. They're present. Let's build or buy specialized solutions to get the job done. And my fellow leaders and maybe some people who are thinking about getting into management and future leaders, you know, let's not set up a security program for the sake of it. Let's base it on our fundamental building blocks, look for company and market drivers. You know, placing big bets is really important, but, you know, transformative change happens, you know, little changes, like little iterative changes over time. So let's focus on getting those small incremental changes that will hopefully become bigger. Measuring baseline indicators is not enough. Let's move beyond that. Let's look at how mitigations can drive down kind of the relative risk that we talked about. And for my fellow technology partners, you know, we need point solutions. We need products that plug into our existing infrastructure. And if your product can solve the main problem and then also maybe solve some of the adjacent problems, then it's a real win for us. That's all I have. Thank you for having me. And a huge thanks to everyone who's listed here. My kids who've been eating boxed mac and cheese for 3 days in a row because mommy had to work on a big presentation. So yeah, big thanks to everyone.
Thank you so much, Swati. Anyone who has questions for Swati, you can raise your hands.
Or if someone's been keeping track of the bingo cards, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. I can repeat my question. So we mentioned about when we're looking at vendors and partners, we want to look at generalized versus specialized, and then we're looking at solutions versus platforms. So when we are preferring specialized solutions, how do we look at platforms in that case?
Yeah, I think, you know, platform strategy is generally like a really good strategy. So if you have like a specific platform that you're thinking about buying, and then to see, okay, will that, can it solve some of the other problems we have, right? That's usually good. But if it is like this really specific problem that potentially not a lot of other people in the market are going to have, probably building something is kind of the way to go, I would say. And I think it's also depends on, you know, what type of industry you're in. Like if it's a problem in a specific industry, then likely maybe somebody else has the same problem, and the chances are there is a product gonna be available probably higher. There's one example, like I remember when we were when I was on the Netflix incident response team, we were looking for a case management solution, but all the solutions were like really big. It was like SOAR, they would plug into this and plug into that, and we just didn't want that. We just needed a simple solution, right? So it made sense. But here at Oracle now, like we need the whole gamut. Like we need the threat response piece, we need a few other things. So kind of buying one of the platforms made sense for us, yeah.
Working in several places that I'm quite familiar with, and you mentioned now investing in a red team. So when do we invest in a red team?
Yeah, good question. So in general, I think if there is a sizable kind of defense operations program, right, if that's ongoing, and then you have a risk management program, maybe that's gone a little bit further than basic. So you have kind of those two pieces. I think it would be a good time to kind of start investing in a red team. Because I think at that point, if you're kind of running simulations, one of the big things about the red team is a lot of risk is created from that, right? So kind of using that lever and saying that, okay, here are all these problems, that's great, but then from there, how do we fix those problems? So if you kind of don't have the rest of the infrastructure or rest of the team set up who can help with kind of fixing that problem, I think it would be quite difficult. It would be a lot of like risk generation and not as much closing down the risk. Yes.
Hi, so my question is about, you know, so your presentation was about building the security program from the ground up. What about existing security programs? Let's say we want to make change in our current processes, all of that stuff. Where do we begin, and how does your presentation differ if we're starting from somewhere?
Yeah, actually, it would be the same. So if this is not just from starting from ground up, but say you're going into a new place, and you're trying to figure out the lay of the land, you know, trying to figure out, you know, what is the existing strategy of build versus buy? What stage of the maturity is this existing program in? So I think that's one of the things that what I've laid out, I think, will work definitely for if you're going into a new place with an existing program. So it works for if you're building a team, probably slightly different because, you know, startups work differently. And but yeah, if you are going into a program, if you're inheriting one, if you're building one, or you have one that you are tasked with increasing the maturity or increasing the effectiveness, I think this would work for all those three scenarios. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Good deal.
Yeah.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us, and thank you, Swati, for joining us for the keynote today. You can enjoy the talks, which are there now, and we would be seeing you soon again. Thank you. Have a good day.